coordinated jointly by members of the Center of Ecumenical, Missiological and Environmental Studies and the Scientific Committee and Teaching Staff of its program, as well as by the Ecumenical Institute of the Pontifical University of St. Thomas, known widely as Angelicum, inaugurated this evening by its director, Reverend Professor Hyacinth Destivelle. In this program, will also participate in various capacities, scholars from the Ecumenical Monastery of Boze and the Oriental Orthodox and Greek Catholic Churches, always scheduled at 6 o'clock in the afternoon Greek time or 5 o'clock Italian time, and always lasting maximum 1.5 hours. Both the Center of Ecumenical, Missiological and Environmental Studies and Angelicum decided to devote this academic year's open public lectures to the relations between the Eastern and Oriental Orthodox churches and the Catholic Church, both the Latin and Roman and the Eastern Greek one. Parallel to these English lectures, this academic year, CEMES will also inaugurate a series of open public lectures in Greek for the Greek-speaking public around the globe on the same general theme and the same time starting next week, next Tuesday. Now, in both the English and the Greek series of lectures, in addition to the speaker and the coordinator, two more scholars will be joining them for an in-depth discussion in an as much as possible balanced form. I take the opportunity, because of today's main speaker, to recall the Ut unum sint, famous papal encyclical, which is also mentioned in the Saint, in the Ecumenical Institute of Angelicum. To believe in Christ means to desire unity. To desire unity means to desire the church. To desire the church means to desire the communion of grace, which corresponds to the Father's plan for from all eternity. This is the meaning of Christ's prayer, that may all be one. Ut unum sint. Now, of course, despite the successful outcome of the official theological dialogues, both between Eastern and Oriental Orthodox Church and the Eastern and Oriental Orthodox Church with the Catholic Church, no significant step toward Eucharistic union has been achieved so far due to certain preoccupations that this series of lectures plans to analyze and, if possible, overcome any canonical, historical, ecclesiological, theological, etc. obstacle that still stands against our Lord's command that we may all be one. So in this full year, full academic year series of lectures, we will try to engage in as many as possible areas that will help our churches to succeed as soon as possible what we hope and pray for, the Eucharistic union. Now, allow me to introduce the main speaker, Father Hyacinth Destivelle was born in Paris in 1970 and in 1994 joined the Order of Preachers. He was specialized in the Slavic Orthodox Christianity. He took his PhD in Slavic studies at the University of Paris in Sorbonne, also a PhD in religious science at St. Sergius Orthodox Theological Institute, also in Paris, but also in Russia in philosophy, the PhD in philosophy at St. Petersburg State University. He is currently the director of the Institute for Ecumenical Studies of the Pontifical University of St. Thomas Aquinas in Rome since 2019. And he is an official at the Pontifical Council for Promoting Christian Unity, responsible for the Slavic Orthodox Christianity, Orthodox churches at the beginning from 2013 till 2018. And then for the Oriental Orthodox churches from that year, 2018 till now. That's why we have also a representative, a famous representative from the Oriental Orthodox community of churches, Father K.M. George. He served as a parish priest at St. Catherine of Alexandria in St. Petersburg during his studies there. And he was director of the Istina Center for Ecumenical Studies in Paris for 5 years, 2005 to 2010. He's a member of the Joint International Commission for Theological Dialogue between the Catholic Church and the Orthodox Church since 2014, and member of the St. Irenaeus Joint Orthodox Catholic Working Group. And since last year, he is also collaborating with the Center of Ecumenical, Missiological, and Environmental Studies in Thessaloniki. Now, some of his main publications deal with actually the Eastern Orthodox tradition, the Christians of the East after communism, the science, the theological science in Russia, reform and renewal of the academic ecclesiastical of the ecclesiastical academies at the beginning of the 20th century, all published by Cerf, the Edition de Cerf in Paris all these years. The Council of Moscow, the famous Great Sobor of 1917 to 1918, and the creation of the conciliar institutions in the Orthodox, in the Russian Orthodox Church. He is a specialist in areas of ecumenism, ecclesiology, synodality, in the Catholic Orthodox dialogue, and in the history of the Russian Orthodox Church. So, we give the floor to Professor Reverend Hyacinth Destivelle to give us to give us the presentation, which was announced in our media. Father Hyacinth, the floor is yours.
Thank you so much, Professor Vassiliadis, for your kind words and for this introduction. on this day in which we celebrate the feast of the Apostle Andrew, the first called and brother of the Apostle Peter, the traditional message of the Bishop of Rome to the Ecumenical Patriarch takes up a now classic expression to describe the current relations between the Catholic Church and the Orthodox Church, namely, I quote, the profound bond that already unites us, and above all, the path towards full communion. These expressions, which seem now classic to Catholic ecclesiology, actually go back to the Second Vatican Council, whose decree, Unitatis Redintegratio, used for the first time the concept of imperfect communion. This terminology was and is still not always understood in some Orthodox circles marked by a primarily Eucharistic or canonical vision, according to which ecclesial communion does not admit degrees. It either exists or it does not, even if the application of the principle of economia allows for exceptions. Conversely, the current situation of rupture of communion between two Orthodox churches is also sometimes difficult to understand for some Catholics accustomed to thinking of schism primarily in reference to a center and not between local churches. How has the Catholic Church understood schism in its nature, causes and effects? Why and how has its view on divisions and on those whom Vatican II calls separated brethren changed in the 20th century? The following observations do not claim to set out new or systematic considerations, but to recall the main recent development of the Catholic Church on this question. So my paper is entitled From Schism to Imperfect Communion, the Development of the Catholic Church's View on the Division of Christians. After a first part dedicated to the evolution of the notion of schism, we try to define what the Catholic Church means by the expression imperfect communion. While the existence of the divisions inherent to the Christian community can be traced to the New Testament, the understanding of schism, its origins, its consequences, and the status of schismatics has necessarily evolved over time. The concept of schism was perceived differently according to the tangible divisions that emerged in history, and especially in the way in which the unity of the church was conceived and the church itself was understood. One can perceive a fundamental development in the Catholic understanding of schism. From an original conception that was fundamentally local, it moved to a universal vision centered on the figure of the Pope. Indeed, for Saint Ignatius of Antioch, as later for Saint Cyprian of Carthage, and then again for the Council of Antioch in 341, the decisive criterion for schism relates to the local church. The schismatic is one who separates from his bishop and erects an altar outside of this authority. For Cyprian in particular, schism is conceived above all as a rupture of unity of which the bishop is the principle and the criterion. Of course, schism has also a universal dimension. This is primarily because the episcopate possessed by the heads of the local churches is considered to be a single undivided reality, and therefore to separate from a legitimate bishop means to separate from the communion of the whole church. It should also be recalled in this context that in the controversy with Donatists, Augustine makes reference to the apostolic churches as criteria of unity and communion, and especially for Augustine to the Church of Rome, wherein, as he said, the Cathedra Petri is located, but more broadly to all the sees directly founded by the apostles. However, the perspective of schism remains essentially local, the episcopal function being the pivot of ecclesial unity, both locally and universally. From the Gregorian Reformation, the point of view changes. A shift in values takes place in the conception of the unity of the church, emphasizing the Roman See. The understanding of schism is modified accordingly. Once considered essentially from the perspective of the local church, it is now considered in the context of the universal church and in reference to the Pope as sole guarantor and criterion of unity. The definition given by St. Thomas Aquinas articulates this vertical vision of schism, also called unity of orientation, as refusal to submit, to a more horizontal dimension, the denial of communion with other members of the church, called unity of connection. Thomas Aquinas starts from the definition of unity. The unity of the church, he explains, I quote, consists in two things, namely in the mutual connection or communion of the members of the church and in the subordination of all the members of the church to the one head. Consequently, I quote, those who refuse to submit to the sovereign pontiff and to hold communion with those members of the church who acknowledge his supremacy are called schismatics. End of quote. As we can see, the second dimension is very directly dependent on the first, since it is with the members subject to the Pope that it is illicit to break the communion. At the same time, as this development from a local understanding to universal conception of schism, three clarifications will gradually be made. The first concerns the distinction between schism and heresy. Saint Cyprian did not differentiate between them, but the Donatist controversy gives Saint Augustine the opportunity to distinguish the break in charity and the opposition in the faith. However, facing the obstinacy of the Donatists, Augustine will develop his thought on this distinction, believing that a schism becomes heresy by the very duration of the primitive dissent. Saint Jerome will go further by saying that there is no schism which, to justify its cessation, does not produce heresy. Thomas Aquinas will synthesize the Western tradition by saying that, I quote, just as faith and charity are different virtues, although whoever lacks faith lacks charity, so too schism and heresy are different vices, although whoever is a heretic is also a schismatic, but not conversely. End of quote. The link between schism and heresy is therefore asymmetrical, since every heretic is schismatic, but not every schismatic is heretical. A second question, which was at the heart of the Donatist controversy, concerned the value of the sacraments of schismatics. It is to this time that we can date the theory of the elements or endowments of church formulated by Saint Augustine, who thought against the Donatists to justify the Roman practice not to rebaptize the schismatics returning to the Catholic Church, since the baptism received in the schism remained that of Christ, who baptizes through the minister. The Augustinian position recognizing the validity prevailed on that which refers to Cyprian. It allowed the Latin tradition to establish theologically the validity of every baptism by water properly conferred in the name of the Holy Trinity, and led to the distinction between validity and licity of the sacraments. A related problem concerned the question of the power of schismatics, that is to say, their capacity and or legitimacy to minister the sacraments. If Thomas Aquinas recognized to schismatics the power of order, that is the sacramental power, but not the power of jurisdiction, the latter tradition will be divided on the question of the jurisdiction of Eastern churches. A third question concerned the type of communicatio in sacris that could exist between Catholics and schismatics. A great variety of practice and discipline has existed according to geographical contexts and periods of history. We know that until the 18th century, communicatio in sacris was practiced between Catholics and Orthodox in the Middle East. It was indeed only in 1729 that the propaganda fide decreed the prohibition of any communicatio in sacris with Christians who were not in communion with Rome. This decree indicates by default that until then, so until almost the middle of the 18th century, sacramental communion between Orthodox and Catholics was still in force in some regions, or at least tolerated. A new reading of the question of schism, of which Yves Congar was one of the leading promoters, emerged on the eve of the Second Vatican Council. In chapter 6 of his 1937 book, These United Christians, Principles of a Catholic Ecumenism, Congar seeks to understand the origin of the events of 1054. Long regarded by historiography as the date of the so-called schism between the Catholic Church and the Orthodox Church. Referring to dogmatic causes in a simple appendix of his study, Congar emphasizes anthropological factors. I quote, "What divides us the most," he explains, "is not so much objects than the manner of approaching them. A question of mentality, much more than a question of objective principle, or rather a question of anthropology," end of quote. This mentality, according to Congar, derives primarily from a diverse theological approach, or even from a different theological temperament, but also from political and social conditions, and more properly, cultural factors. Beyond a reflection on the roots of the schism, Congar asks the question in chapter 7, what are the dissidents and the dissident churches in the eyes of the One Church. It is the title of this chapter. After questioning the status of individual schismatics, he is interested in the status of dissident Christianity. Konga takes up the theory of the church elements. So this theory, going back to Augustine, he says, if we cannot say that dissident Christianities are members of the Una Ecclesia, we can, however, it seems to me, say that they are, in various degrees, church elements. They are church elements since they have kept more or less in what constitutes their sociological reality as a religious body, elements or realizing principles of the one church. I remind that it is written in 1937. While baptism is a common good for all Christians, Konga noted that there is, however, quite a difference between Eastern and Western communities, the first having preserved the apostolic succession and therefore all the sacraments. He refers in this regard to the well-known speech pronounced in 1927 by Pope Pius XI, who said, with reference to Eastern Christianities, I quote, separate fragments of an auriferous rock are auriferous too. 2 years later, Konga's article on schism, published in 1939 in the Dictionnaire de Théologie Catholique, gives him the opportunity to offer a first historical and speculative synthesis on this question. Beyond the aspects already noted, let us note a remark on the national dimension of schisms, particularly interesting in the light of current events. Indeed, reflecting on the various factors leading to schism, Konga discerns in Donatism an element of revolt in non-Romanized Numidia against Carthage. Similarly, Konga perceives an opposition to Byzantine rule in Egypt and Syria in the separations which in the 6th century led to the creation of the Coptic and Jacobite churches. Likewise, national sentiment, Konga notes, played a considerable role in Hussitism, Lutheranism, and Anglicanism. I quote, it would be very fruitful to study the relations between nationalism and schism as a refusal to behave ut pars, end of quote. Konga refines his analysis in the extensive article published in 1954 on the occasion of the 900th anniversary of what was called the Eastern Schism. The roots of the schism, always written in quotation mark in the book of Konga, are presented in the different order from 1937. Anthropological facts give way to political factors. But above all, schism is presented there not as a rupture of dissidence caused by some disagreements regarding right or doctrine, but as a common and progressive estrangement, in English in the text, since there is no exact French equivalent. By this term, estrangement, Konga means three things. First, the separation was not realized as a sharp break during the anathemas, but as a gradual evolution that began before the 11th century and continued after. Precisely in that it was a long process and not a precise act, Konga believes that, I quote, the schism, in so far as it is an estrangement, is not consumed. The schism is not consumed. This view will be shared by an Orthodox theologian like Callistus Ware, arguing about the break that, I quote, perhaps indeed the process never has been finally concluded, end of quote. Konga's second conviction is that the this unity was not the result of a unilateral initiative for which only dissidents would bear the responsibility, but a common process, a mutual disaffection, a shared ignorance, and above all, the acceptance of this, I quote, state of mutual ignorance. The Eastern Schism, he explains, and I quote again, appears to us as constituted by the acceptance of a situation where each part of Christianity lives, behaves, and judges without taking the other into account, end of quote. Finally, and this is undoubtedly the most interesting aspect of his analysis, Congar observes that the break was not caused by a few punctuated disagreements over rights, discipline, or doctrine, but by a general misunderstanding concerning everything. Certainly, Congar's study classifies the main points of misunderstanding, distinguishing political, cultural, and finally ecclesiological aspects. But none of these factors taken in isolation is enough to explain the separation. In reality, explains Congar, everything is fundamentally common to the East and the West, and everything is different. This new vision of schism proposed by the works of Yves Congar and other theologians and historians contributed to a radical change of perspective during the Second Vatican Council. And I start now my second part. This evolution concerned three main points: a modification of the vocabulary concerning the other Christians, second, a systematic application of the theory of the endowments or elements of the church, and third, the introduction of the notion of imperfect communion. So first, the modification of the vocabulary concerning the other Christians. The theological qualification of non-Catholic Christians is presented in paragraph 3 of the Decree Unitatis Redintegratio, whose principles of interpretation are provided by the dogmatic constitution on the church, Lumen Gentium, especially in paragraph 15. The constitution, Lumen Gentium, no longer uses, as in the past for non-Catholics, the terms schismatics or dissidents, but by virtue of their baptism, calls them Christians. I quote, "The church recognizes that in many ways she is linked, so ecclesia semetipsam novit plures obrationes conjunctam, is linked with those who, being baptized, are honored by, with the name of Christian, though they do not profess the faith in its entirety or do not preserve unity of communion with the successor of Peter," end of quote. With reference to this link, conjunctam, the Constitution refers to the apostolic letter Preclara Gratulationis of 1894, in which the Pope Leo XIII, calling for the unity of Christians from East and West, underlined the existing links between Latin and Eastern Christianity. Like the dogmatic constitution, Lumen Gentium, the Decree Unitatis Redintegratio abandons the category of schism to speak of separation. This separation is not attributed solely to the separated. Actually, the decree, which always uses the passive formula were separated, states that for this separation, men of both sides were to blame. I quote, in other words, Catholics too were guilty. As Pius XI had already pointed out in his speech of 1927, recognizing that, I quote, Catholics lacked the right appreciation of their duties. In addition, the decree Unitatis Redintegratio distinguishes between those who create division and those who are born in separate communities, because the latter, I quote, cannot be accused of the sin involved in the separation. This is an important point, which the Council clarifies. Neither the Orthodox nor the Protestants can be held responsible for a rupture which took place several centuries before them. There is even every reason to believe in their good faith, because born and raised in families separated from the Catholic Church, they only followed the tradition bequeathed to them by their ancestors. A second development concerns the application to other Christian communities of the so-called theory of church elements or endowments. Lumen Gentium affirms that, I quote, many elements of sanctification and of truth are found outside of the visible structure of the Catholic Church. While Unitatis Redintegratio sees in these communities, I quote, the significant elements and endowments which together go to build up and give life to the church. What are these ties, I quote, ties which still bind Catholics to their separated brethren? Without claiming to be exhaustive, Lumen Gentium 15 enumerates seven. Four are common to all Christians: sacred scripture, sincere zeal, faith in God the Father and Christ the Son of God, and baptism. Three other bonds are added for Eastern Christians: the Episcopate, the Eucharist, the Marian cult. To these ties, the Constitution adds, I quote, they also share with us in prayer and other spiritual benefits, and even communion in prayer and in other spiritual benefits. And even in some real way, they are joined with us in the Holy Spirit, who has strengthened them to the extent of the shedding of their blood. Here we see that Lumen Gentium offers the foundation of the so-called ecumenism of martyrdom or ecumenism of blood, so often mentioned by Pope John Paul II and Pope Francis. In enumerating these church endowments, Unitatis Redintegratio, for its part, mentions baptism in first place. I quote Unitatis Redintegratio, chapter 3, paragraph 3, all who have been justified by faith in baptism are members of Christ's body and have a right to be called Christian, and so are correctly accepted as brothers by the children of the Catholic Church, end of quote. The conciliar document refers here to two texts. The first is the Exultate Deo, Bull of Union of Armenians of the Council of Florence, 1439, which speaks of other Christians are bearing the seal of Christ and presents baptism as the sacrament making the baptized, I quote, a member of Christ and of the body of the church. The second text is St. Augustine's commentary on Psalm 32, which uses the expression separated brothers about those who are baptized by, I quote, by not repeating their baptism and recognizing ours, we tell them, you are our brothers, says Augustine, who adds further, they are really our brothers, whether they want it or not, end of quote. The significance of baptism and the conviction of the baptismal fraternity of all Christians is one of the fundamental principles of the ecumenical movement, as well as of the conciliar decree itself. But in addition to baptism, the decree Unitatis Redintegratio cites other existing elements, I quote, outside the visible boundaries of the Catholic Church, namely the written word of God, the life of grace, faith, hope, and charity with the other interior gifts of the Holy Spirit and visible elements too. End of quote. All of these, which come from Christ and lead back to him, belong by right to the one Church of Christ, explains the decree, which here implicitly distinguishes the Catholic Church from the larger reality of the one Church of Christ. Furthermore, the decree recognizes that the liturgical actions of other Christians, I quote, must be regarded as capable of giving access to the community of salvation, even if the Catholic Church is, I quote, the whole embracing means of salvation. The Eastern churches occupy a special place since the decree recognizes that they possess, I quote, true sacraments, above all by apostolic succession, the priesthood and the Eucharist, whereby they are linked with us in closest intimacy, end of quote. This recognition, besides traditional of the apostolic succession of the Eastern churches, not only makes it possible to recognize a full ecclesiality to the Eastern churches, but also to place the separation between East and West within the church and not between two churches, as had the Council of Florence in its definition letter to Shelley of 1439, quoted by Unitatis Redintegratio, I quote, the barrier dividing the Eastern Church and Western churches will be removed, and that at last there may be but the one dwelling firmly established of Christ Jesus, the cornerstone, who will make both one. End of quote. It is also by virtue of this recognition that the decree considers that some worship in common, communicatio in sacris, given suitable circumstances and the approval of church authority, is not only possible, but to be encouraged. Other common elements already unite the Eastern churches and the Catholic Church. Indeed, I quote, the churches of the East have had a treasury from which the Western Church has drawn extensively in liturgical practice, spiritual tradition, and law. Moreover, it was the ecumenical councils held in the East that defined the basic dogmas of the Christian faith on the Trinity, on the Word of God, who took flesh of the Virgin Mary. It is from the East also that the West received the cult of the Virgin Mary, proclaimed Mother of God by the Council of Ephesus. It is also in the East that monastic spirituality flourished, which then later flowed over into the Western world and there provided the source from which Latin monastic life took its rise and has drawn fresh vigor ever since, end of quote. Let us conclude these observations by saying that the conciliar text, while taking up the Augustinian ecclesiology of church elements or church endowments, are animated by a totally different spirit. First, the Augustinian theory was based on the idea of larceny, according to which the schismatics stole the sacrament from the Catholic Church. The decree, in contrast, speaks of the church elements or endowments in terms of belonging by right to the one Church of Christ. Another difference characterizes the spirit of the decree. While Augustine was convinced with all the ancient church that the baptism of heretics and schismatics ministered outside the legitimate church could not confer the Holy Spirit and therefore had no salvific efficacy, for the decree Unitatis Redintegratio, every validly baptized Christian is established in a fundamental communion with the Church of Christ on earth. Third point of the second part, an imperfect communion. If the presentation of church endowments is classic, the novelty of Vatican II lies especially in the adoption of the concept of imperfect communion. I quote Unitatis Redintegratio, paragraph 3, for men who believe in Christ and have been truly baptized are in communion with the Catholic Church, even though this communion is imperfect. We can affirm with the great ecumenist André de Halleux that, I quote, the notion of communion more or less perfect or more or less full, which binds all Christians to the Church, is the great ecclesiological principle which commands Catholic engagement in ecumenism, end of quote. It seems that the expression full and perfect communion comes from Pope Paul VI. One of its first uses dates back to 18 August 1963 at the Grotta Ferrata Abbey, when Paul VI evoked the Eastern churches, I quote, which are not in perfect communion with the Church of Rome. During a speech to the Plenary Assembly of the Italian Episcopate on 14 April 1964, widening the perspective to the whole Christian world, Paul VI mentioned, I quote, the reconstitution of perfect communion with separated Christian brothers as one of the main goals of the current council. In defining ecclesial relationships, the Second Vatican Council uses the words incorporation, bond, ordination, and communion, four words. Lumen Gentium distinguishes indeed between the full incorporation into the Church of the Catholic faithful possessing the Spirit of Christ, so incorporation for the Catholics, the bond linking non-Catholic Christians to the Church, and finally, the ordination to the people of God of all men who have not yet received the gospel. Incorporation, bond, ordination. Unitatis Reintegratio takes up the word bond to evoke, I quote, the bonds which exist in spite of division. However, the word bond has seemed too general to qualify theologically the relations between Christians. The decree also takes up the notion of incorporation for non-Catholic Christians, speaking of, I quote, the one body of Christ on earth to which all should be fully incorporated who belong in any way to the people of God. However, while the concept of incorporation values the ecclesial meaning of baptism, it does not really allow for graduality in relation to the Church, and therefore seems less apt than that of communion upon which to base an ecumenical ecclesiology. This is why the term favored by the decree Unitatis Redintegratio is that of communion, described as full or imperfect. To better understand this expression, it is first necessary to reflect on the word communion, koinonia, which comes from the Greek kinos, meaning that which is in common, can be defined as the common participation in the same good. Koinonia, therefore, does not mean a bilateral relationship, but a common participation in a third reality. For Christians, it entails participation in God himself. Thus, St. Paul says that God called us to koinonia with his Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. St. John makes more explicitly the link between communion of Christians and participation in the divine life. What we have seen and heard, we proclaim now to you, so that you too may have koinonia with us, for our koinonia is with the Father and with his Son, Jesus Christ. It is in this sense that the origin of the expression communio sanctorum must be understood, communion in the holy things before that of the communion of saints. The word communion, therefore, first refers to the communion of Christians in the same mystery before designating the communion among them. The reference to the mystery of Christ and to his gift to humanity to constitute his Church is the right way to appreciate the communion existing between the churches, as explained Cardinal Johannes Willebras, at that time president of the Secretariat for Christian Unity. I quote, "This is a definitely Christocentric approach of our relations with the churches or ecclesial communities with which we are not in full communion. Indeed," he said, "we do not consider them in relation to us. We consider them and ourselves in relation to Christ and to his mystery." Thus, states Cardinal Willebrand, I quote, "we speak of partial or imperfect communion between the divided churches according to whether they participate in these gifts of the Spirit, according to whether they agree on the content of their expression of faith, according to whether they celebrate the sacraments and the Eucharistic liturgy, according to whether they benefit from the apostolic ministry and from its articulation of Catholic unity," end of quote. This last reflection of Cardinal Willebrand enables us to better understand the content of the perfect communion to which the Council refers. Lumen Gentium, to define the full incorporation of the faithful into the Church, takes up the trilogy, classical since Bellarmine, of union in faith, in sacraments, and in ministry. Faith, sacraments, ministry. That is to say, the presence of all essential ecclesial elements of a doctrinal, sacramental, and canonical nature. These three dimensions correspond to the triamunera of Christ, in which all Christians participate to various degrees by virtue of their baptism, ministry of teaching, sanctifying, and governing. In the same way, the communion between still divided Christians is rooted in the communion with Christ in his three functions of prophet, priest, and king. In each of these three dimensions, Christians of various denominations already live a certain communion in the common faith, in the Word of God, and in the confession of God the Father and Christ, Son, and of God and Savior. In the sacraments of baptism, and for some in the Eucharist, and in the apostolic succession and the episcopal ministry. Communion is imperfect because each of these three dimensions lacks certain elements which vary from one community to another. This explains the Council's use of the expression churches and ecclesial communities to designate other Christians. As there are degrees of communion, there are many degrees of ecclesiality. The church endowments, which Unitatis Redintegratio enumerates as elements of a still imperfect communion, fall under two orders, visible and invisible. Visible and invisible elements can exist outside the visible boundaries of the Catholic Church, as said Unitatis Redintegratio 3. And certainly, the decree does not adopt the dialectic of the visible-invisible familiar to the Lutheran tradition. However, it seems that two aspects cross the three dimensions of faith, sacraments, and ministry. While the written word of God and baptism are part of the visible elements, the life of grace, faith, hope, and charity, the other gifts of the Holy Spirit, including what Pope Francis calls ecumenism of blood, are invisible. So it seems that we can distinguish two dimensions of communion by which ecumenism defines the unity of the Church: an ontological or spiritual dimension, which is part of the mystery of the Church, and an institutional or canonical dimension at the level of the visible Church. Two dimensions which certain theologians call ecclesial communion and ecclesiastical communion. But of course, to these two dimensions of communion, so the ontological and the institutional, It is undoubtedly necessary to add a third one, the sacramental, which is the summit and the expression of the perfect communion, the Eucharistic communion. Conclusion. The understanding of schism, its roots and its effects depended very much in the Catholic Church on how the unity of the Church and the Church itself was conceived. Thus, in parallel with the evolution of Catholic ecclesiology, increasingly making the Roman See the criterion of its unity, the conception of schism was gradually refined and allowed the development of theological and canonical distinctions between schism and heresy, between unity of orientation and unity of connection, between validity and licity, between power of order and power of jurisdiction. If historically the conception of the Church determined that of schism, we can say conversely that the renewed perspective on other Christians has changed deeply the understanding of the Church. Indeed, in the 20th century, the ecumenical movement has profoundly changed the perception of the divisions and the notion of schism to the point that the latter has practically disappeared from the perspective. The notion of communion has occupied a growing place, not only to define the Church, but also as a vision of unity. Koinonia has emerged as a concept more suited to the ecumenical path than that of unity, not only because it helps to affirm the existence of a real existing Christian fellowship across divisions, but also because it admits degrees of communion. Moreover, like the Trinitarian koinonia, the notion of communion allows more easily than the notion of unity, often understood as uniformity, to integrate a legitimate diversity. Finally, the notion of communion implies the communication, the relationship, on the model of the relations of reciprocity and gift between the persons of the Holy Trinity, and thus promotes the exchange of gifts between the churches as the privileged way of unity. This imperfect communion in faith, sacraments, and ministry is understandable only if we distinguish three types of communion: ontological, canonical, and Eucharistic. When the Catholic Church speaks of imperfect communion, it is an ontological and spiritual communion, certainly incomplete but real, in faith, sacraments, and ministries, not yet manifested in the canonical communion nor expressed in the Eucharistic communion. This is what Paul VI wrote in his letter to Patriarch Athenagoras during his visits to Fanar in July 1967, which is probably the most complete expression of his thought on this subject. And I will conclude with this quote. I quote, "Since on both sides we profess the basic dogmas of the Christian faith on the Trinity, on the Word of God, who took flesh of the Virgin Mary, as they were defined by the ecumenical councils held in the East, and since we have in common true sacraments and the hierarchical priesthood, we must first of all, in the service of our holy faith, work fraternally to find together the appropriate and progressive forms to develop and actualize in the life of our churches the communion which, though imperfect, already exists." Thank you.
Thank you, Father Hyacinth. It was an excellent introduction to this series, presenting the way, you call it, evolution of the Catholic view about schism, or from schism to an imperfect communion. I think together with next week's Orthodox approach towards the non-existing schism will give more impetus to thinking about how we can overcome the last obstacles. So far, we thought that only primacy versus synodality were the important issues. However, since we have now two distinguished members of the Greek Catholic community and the Oriental Orthodox family of churches, I would immediately give the floor to those two who are the debaters in today's presentation. So, either Father Ihor or Father George are welcome to comment or make further remarks towards this Eastern, Western estrangement, as if Kongar said. And by the way, I can inform the public, those who listen to us, that there is a special presentation on the pneumatology and the contribution of Yves Gongard in this rapprochement between East and West. Now, the floor is yours, Father George, Father Ihor, whoever wants.
Can I?
Yes. Petros?
Okay. thank you, dear friend and brother Petros, for this remarkable initiative for an ecumenical discussion on the issues which separate us historically and theologically, and the vision to come together. I would say that we have two points. We originally were one body, were East or West, North or South. The Church of Christ originally was one body. And now we speak of the union, the one body of the Church ultimately. So between our initial experience of unity and our eschatological vision of unity, we have some problems. So I would say our approach should be in that way, that we are not divided from the very beginning. We were one from the beginning, but then we are divided, and we are not going to be divided at the end, but we are going to be one, okay? Now, well, my concern, as you know, is particularly about the relation between the Oriental Orthodox churches and the Eastern Orthodox churches. At the next circle, of course, with the Catholic Church and the Protestant churches. I am very happy that Father Hyacinth has given us a very clear and comprehensive view of the issues between the East and the West. And I am very happy about the expression he chose to describe that, evolution. The word evolution is very significant, particularly when you speak about doctrinal issues, because many people seem to think that there is no evolution in the doctrinal life of the church. What the fathers said in the second century or fourth century is exactly the same that we proclaim today in the 21st century. Well, essentially, yes. Essentially, we proclaim the same Christ. The same Christ, yesterday, today, and tomorrow. That's fine. But the way we interpret and the tools we use for interpretation, like the linguistic tools, the cultural tools, etc., they are different. And that is why we need to struggle with it, because in the first century or the fifth century at the time of the Council of Chalcedon in 451 AD, of course, the Greek language was the dominant language. And the Oriental Orthodox churches were having different languages, the Syrian, the Coptic, the Ethiopian, the Indian, the Armenian, you know, a multiplicity of languages. Of course, there was a difficulty of communicating between the dominant language and the rest of languages. You know, I, from India, I can see it very well, because in India, Sanskrit was the dominant language for maybe for three millennia. But in India, such a big country, you have many other languages. And between Sanskrit and the other languages, sometimes there arose a conflict. I'm just suggesting that the linguistic tools we use can be a hindrance to our mutual understanding. But we are linguistic beings. We cannot do away with language or concept. This is a point where we show our Christianity. We should be able to transcend the linguistic and cultural tools we use for interpretation. So this is a question of methodology in theology, question of hermeneutics. I come back to the word evolution, because in evolution there is a movement, there is some dynamism. Of course, it is our understanding of evolution. When we proclaim, for example, the fundamental doctrine of the union of the divine and the human in the one person, one hypostasis of Christ Jesus, we are also having this infinite dynamic movement, because it is not a one-time, it's not a one-time event of God and humanity becoming one. Yes, historically, yes, in Jesus Christ, it happened. But that happening had been there, as the scripture says, from before the foundation of the earth. And that happening is continuing towards the end of history, towards the culmination of all creation. So let us keep that dynamism in our doctrinal understanding. And of course, between the persons in the Trinity, the relationship between the persons in the Trinity is also not a static one. And our fathers are very, very careful about it, not to number them, not to make it a hierarchy of 1, 2, 3, etc. Because at the back of their minds, they were seized by the sense of mystery, which transcended the enumeration, the numerical counting, the conceptual divisions, etc. So the dynamism within the Trinity, the dynamism within the union between the human and the divine, this is fundamental for our understanding. When we compromise with that, well, we will come into sort of war of words, as St. Gregory the theologian used that expression, the logomachia, the war of words.
Thank you, Father George. Thank you, Father George. It was excellent further comment to our common journey. And yes, I would immediately give the floor also to Father Ihor, who represent another important, like Father George's Oriental Orthodox family, represents an important element towards reuniting the originally one church, as he mentioned. Father Ihor, with the up to very scandalous unit presence. Now, after the so-called Ukrainian crisis, they became, especially in Ukraine, the Ukrainian Greek Catholic Church, a very important instrument towards the so-called rapprochement again of East and West. Father Ihor, the floor is yours. I mentioned some time that Ukraine is the center of the world. If the journey towards unity fails in Ukraine, it will fail for all Christianity. Father Ihor.
Thank you, Professor Vassiliadis, and also for your optimistic about Ukraine. But first of all, thank you, Professor Destivelle, for such very nice, interesting, and excellent speech. I think we were good informed about this schism in history and as well as perfect or imperfect communion in the future. It was very interesting in the history, but right now in the new age, and especially in Ukraine, we faced a lot of different ways of continuing of the schism. And as Pope John Paul II said, we are in a laboratory of ecumenism. But anyway, today we are not about planning some big events, but rather building up some human relationship which are specially affected in a condition of pandemic. First of all, I want to say that it is important that ecumenism should not be just a beautiful idea, but a style of our life. When we speak to the world as one church, the only one body of Christ. And we are really striving to hear church speak in one voice, especially here in Ukraine. What was very interesting for me, it's that you mentioned, Professor Destivelle, about some model of unity. You said about based on the Trinity, ecclesiology, Eucharistic ontology. Up to now, we don't really find any model of unity. It also should be my questions to you, if you will have a time to discuss something. I understood that it's not very easy questions, but maybe you as an expert, and I hope you have also your own vision, what kind of model of unity we should taking care in the future. I understood that you, because I'm a Greek Catholic, and all of you already knows about uniatism, and we understand that this method and model are not very good for now, especially method, because the model we can change, even in relationship with the Greek Catholic Church and today's Vatican Curia. And we also ready for these discussions. But can you suggest about your thoughts, about the models you can suggest for us and for students that are listening to us? And especially in today's discussion in Vatican about the synodal path of Catholic Church declared by His Holiness Pope Francis. Maybe just a few words.
Thank you, Father Ihor. Now the floor is again back to you, Father Hyacinth, to respond to what you have heard, go further to make your argument a little bit simpler for the students. Father Ihor, very instrumental in saying that we have to give also to our students. And I demand, or actually require to have as soon as possible the full text so that they can be, I mean, what you said can be read more thoroughly. So, Father Hyacinth.
Thank you, Professor Vassiliadis, and thank you, Father George and Father Igor, for your observations and comments. I will say very briefly something regarding the first comment of Professor George concerning the question of the interpretation, evolution. This was instrumental in the dialogue. I found it very successful in the dialogue between the Catholic Church and the Oriental Orthodox churches. The capacity or very early, in, already in the 70s, in the 80s, to recognize that we can express that some differences in terminology and emphasis are not contradictory with unity. I would like to quote just one sentence. It is the doctrinal agreement on Christology approved by John Paul II and the Catholicos Mar Basilius Mar Thoma Matthews I. It was in 90, and it is very interesting. They said, because the main, as we know, the main controversial point between Catholic Church and the Oriental Orthodox Church, as between the Byzantine and the Oriental Catholic or Oriental Orthodox Church churches, is the Christological controversy about the interpretation of Chalcedon. And John Paul II and the Catholicos Thoma Matthews I were able to say, it is this faith that we both confess, its content is the same in both communion. So the content of the faith is the same. In formulating that content in the course of history, so there is the evolution aspect, differences have arisen in terminology and emphasis. But we are convinced that these differences are such as can coexist in the same communion. These differences can coexist in the same communion and therefore need not and should not divide us. I think it's wonderful. It was a wonderful expression of this, what was called after the differentiated consensus used in the dialogue between the Catholic and the Lutheran about the question of the justification. But I think we need this kind of interpretation of our differences. For example, on the question of the filioque, but perhaps also on ecclesiological issues, the question of primacy and synodality and so on. Because we use words, but very often we formulate the same face with different words, and it takes time to recognize that the differences can coexist in the same communion. This was my first comment regarding the comment. So the model of communion, Father Igor asked the what kind of model of communion. This is the most important question. What kind of model of communion can we propose? And I think the Catholic Church has to make the first step to propose a model of communion, because the model of communion, for example, of the Oriental Catholic Churches mainly was shaped on the ecclesiology of the Council of Trent, that is the jurisdiction. So we need now a model of communion which should not be primarily jurisdictional. Of course, it should have also some juridical aspects, but not primarily. So what kind of model of communion can the Catholic Church propose to the other Christians, and especially to the Eastern Orthodox and to the Oriental Orthodox, a model of communion which should be not be primarily jurisdictional? This is the whole question. So we can perhaps find some inspiration in the first millennium, We already tried in the Chieti document with a model of communion, not primary jurisdictional between the Church of Rome and the other churches, but nevertheless with two recognized competence, although these competencies should be interpreted also. The first, the regarding the right of appeal, yes, of the Church of Rome. So the second, the question of the role of the Bishop of Rome in the ecumenical councils. These kinds of reflections are necessary because we realize that the primacy is necessary at all level of the church, as it was said already by Ravenna document, the Chieti document. But what is the content of this primacy? This is the whole question. What is new, and I will finish with that, is the perspective, I think, now of the synodal process engaged by Pope Francis. You mentioned also this synodal process. These past years, we considered that there were two competing principles, yes, primacy and synodality. We distinguished at the end the synodality from collegiality. It was not clear, yes, at least in the Catholic understanding. So collegiality is the synodality of the bishops, if we can say so. And the synodality is the broader participation of all the people of God in the life and in the mission of the church. But now I think with Pope Francis, we have a new understanding of this synodality as an including process of primacy. Primacy is part of this synodal dynamic, collegiality also, and now we distinguish the communal aspect of the whole people of God. So the synodal dynamic includes the personal or primacial ministry, but also the collegial dimension, and also the communal or communitarian dimension of the expression of the sensus fidei of the whole people of God. So it is interesting because now we have a primacy included in synodality. And I think it is closer to the Orthodox understanding that the primacy, that so we don't have primacy and we will give a bit of primacy to the Orthodox and we will take a bit of college of synodality from the Orthodox. I think it's a bit, this tension at the end is not very fruitful, but if we consider the synodal dynamic as an inclusive process, which includes the personal, collegial, and communal dimension, it's more fruitful. And I was reading yesterday the introduction of the new apostolic constitution written by Pope Francis in 2018 on the Synod of Bishops. And he says in the introduction that in fact, the reform of the Synod of Bishops, which starts from the people of God and ends to the people of God, is the response to the question of John Paul II in Utunum Sint number 95, to find a way of exercising the ministry of the Bishop of Rome in a way acceptable for all Christians. So the reform of the Synod of Bishops is in some way the response of Pope Francis to the reform of the papacy at the service of the unity.
Thank you very much, Father Hyacinth. The time is over, but I would like to ask my colleague and your colleague, Dimitrios, if he has any short remark to make, and he will, Father Heising, close up and round up today's inaugural open public lecture. Dimitrios.
Yes, good afternoon to all. I have only words of appreciation to Father Destivelle's presentation, which I think helped us Orthodox to understand that and to read Catholic ecclesiology, Catholic ecumenism as a whole, and not to insist on words and expressions that are separated from the general context. So I really appreciated this process that adopted less institutional and more, let's say, sacramental, Eucharistic, spiritual terms and vocabulary to express the ways of communion between the Catholic Church and the other churches and confessions. And I found it very interesting, the distinction regarding the imperfect communion of which Unita de Gratia speaks about, between the institutional, the ontological, and the Eucharistic communion. So, of course, speaking of Eucharistic unity is not an institutional communion. It can inspire institutions. But I would like to ask Father Destivelle if that Eucharistic communion, if there is a tension between Eucharistic communion and ontological spiritual communion, or they express the same reality.
Thank you, Dimitri. Father Hyacinth.
Yes, very. Thank you for your questions, question, Professor Karamidas. Very briefly, as the Eucharistic communion is the expression of the ontological communion. So there is no tension or contradiction, but I think it's just the expression. Of course, as Eucharistic communion can also sometimes be a way, but as an exception, as it is, at least it is authorized in the discipline of the Catholic Church with the Eastern and Orthodox, the Eastern and the Oriental Orthodox Churches. But we share this conviction that the Eucharistic communion is the expression of the ecclesial communion, and that they should not be, they are linked profoundly. And so if we want this, the ecclesial communion is the ontological communion.
Let me express my sincere gratitude to Father Hyacinth Destivelle for his a very insightful presentation, but also allow me to express a thanks also to Father George and to Father Ihor, and we look forward
It is frozen, I'm afraid.
Yeah, the internet lost, I think, in Greece.
In Greece is working, but I think in the neighborhood of the professor. Okay, let me grab the opportunity to thank you as well for the presentation, Father Hyacinth, and the comments. Reverend Dr. Ihor and K.M. George, also Professor Keramidas is in Rome right now. Just a short remark that we're going to continue next week with the lecture of Emeritus Professor Grigorios Larentzakis, whether there exists actually a schism between Rome and Constantinople, that will be coordinated again by the Honorary President of CEMES, Professor Petros Vassiliadis, and will be commended by His Eminence Ioannis Spiteris of the Catholic Church, and His Eminence Dimitrios Salahas, again of the Catholic Church. So thank you very much. Looking forward to see you all. The video will be live, and because it's broadcasted, it will be live soon in the CEMES YouTube channel. And wishing you a pleasant evening. Thank you. Thank you all.
Thank you very much.
Thank you. Thank you so much.